And that takes us to the New Deal, FDR and the New Deal. So what to do? FDR really focuses on really two major areas. Well, there's three. There's one that's not included here. He focuses on what you might call the three R's: reform, relief, and recovery. So the first thing you want to do is you want to reform the system, reform the markets and the banking systems. The banking system was about ready in the United States to collapse in entirety. It was about ready to completely collapse. And so FDR, to prevent that, he calls the national banking holiday, and they close the banks for a week. In that process, Roosevelt calls what he calls his what they call the 100 Days Congress. He called an emergency session of Congress, and he basically really led the Congress in driving through very, very progressive legislation to address the problems of the Depression. It was unprecedented for executive power, unprecedented for executive action. It was very urgent action taken in very urgent times. And FDR knew that, and he won the election on the promise that he would do something. And he started immediately with very, very aggressive reform. And it's important to note that FDR is trying to prevent, a collapse of the system in the United States. He's very fearful. In the world at this time, you have communist movements, you have fascist movements, you have socialism in Europe, you have in the United States and elsewhere, you have a demand from capitalists who want unregulated capitalism regardless of the consequences. Let market force dictate it. FDR is trying to stabilize the United States against this. He's trying to prevent a leftist socialist uprising. He's trying to prevent a rightist fascist movement. He's trying to insulate the country against the damages of an unregulated market attitude. He's trying to stabilize the United States. And so the first thing he does is through the passage of the Glass-Steagall Act. Most significantly, the Glass-Steagall Act, designed to reform the banks, banned commercial banks from stock trading until the 1990s. And actually, you know, that should be some pause for thought right now, because, of course, if you guys know anything about 2008, commercial bank activity in the stock market had become not only relatively common, but unregulated. And you guys might remember that that crisis started really with banks going under, like Societe Generale, as a result of bad market activity. So that was a change that, we might have to think about, regulating bank activity in the market more, because, of course, it created a huge problem in 2008. Also, the creation of the FDIC, the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, which insures your money to a certain amount in federal-sponsored banks, banks that participate, which is pretty much all banks today. They created the SEC, the Securities and Exchange Commission, was also created to regulate the market activity. And that was another body that in 2008, it's well documented that the SEC did not do its job in 2008, that the SEC was being run largely by individuals who believed in more of an unregulated market attitude, that a capitalist market would kind of work everything out. And so they ignored the clear, clear warning signs of the dangerous market activity, particularly being conducted by the banks in 2008. And so the reason that the SEC didn't catch it is because they weren't really doing their job entirely at that time. But the Securities and Exchange Commission has the job of overseeing market activity. That's what it does. And it's designed to regulate the market and to prevent unsafe market activities that could create another crash. Relief, unemployment relief, and not only the development of unemployment programs, but putting people back to work particularly. FDR created a huge amount of government programs that were designed to put people to work. The Tennessee Valley Authority building dams, the CCC, the Civilian Conservation Corps, they went around, they built things like levees on rivers and irrigation projects. The Works Project Administration did things in education. They also did dam building things, Public Works Administration. Very, very significant. These were public works projects, and the people were working on them, and they were being paid by the government. And the government was certainly paying them on money that was building deficits, but it was a kind of controlled Keynesian spending to put people to work and get the economy turning. Of course, also in the area of relief, safety nets like Social Security, relief to homeowners, unemployment relief, were all developments of the New Deal. And of course, Social Security remains a very significant aspect of America's system today, and one that Americans need to very much find a way to make sustainable, because it's not something that should ever be allowed to go away, because the purpose of Social Security is to provide for the elderly who are unable to work. And oftentimes it was, you know, designed for the widow who could no longer work. And that's a very important thing that should not be forgotten in society. And so the United States, I believe, needs to really make sure that Social Security remains sustainable for the foreseeable future. You can click this link if you want. Roosevelt called the 100 Days Congress, as it was so-called. It was emergency action that Roosevelt called and drove through as the executive. And he created a flurry of legislation, many of it just mentioned, designed to address the Depression. And you can click this link here and listen to one of his first, his addressing the bank situation, actually, is what this is, at the outset of the 100 Days Congress. This graph is meant to depict, it shows you unemployment rates in the United States, and so it can kind of show you the curve, just the scale, the extent of the employment problem in the country. And of course, that also doesn't get at the areas where it was as high as, in some places in the Rust Belt, as high as 80% unemployment. This here, this is a depiction of national debt. And it's very noteworthy because you can see that, of course, national debt goes up with the New Deal, clearly. But you can also see that around about 1942, national debt really begins to skyrocket. And that, of course, was because of World War II. And that should put some perspective on things, because you have oftentimes the New Deal is criticized for debt, and it's criticized for excessive government spending. But you can tell that when you compare it to an event like World War II, it was actually quite small potatoes. And of course, it's World War II that people often say pulled the United States out of the Depression. And if that's the case, then there's something to be said for this graph, in the sense of, if indeed that was the case, like the role of deficit spending in pulling the United States out of the Depression, if it was World War II, then certainly there might be some truth in that argument, if that makes any sense. So Social Security. So this is a Social Security board flyer. It was actually challenged it was taken to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court upheld this one. There was two others that, in particular, that the Supreme Court struck down, but Social Security was upheld. One of the New Deal acts that was struck down was the National Recovery Association. This was struck down by the Supreme Court. And the goal of the NRA was basically to mandate codes of business practice. So things like, one of the biggest things was they mandated that businesses could not employ their hour, that they had to employ people for 30-hour work week. I think it was 32-hour work weeks rather than 40-hour work weeks. Because shorter hours meant they would have to employ more people. And so this was one way they tried to establish business codes to respect certain wages, to respect certain hours, to encourage the employment of more people at higher wages. It was found unconstitutional, along with the AAA, which was the Agricultural Adjustment Act. And these two, and this was in 1935 that this happened, and the NRA being found unconstitutional led to a struggle with the Supreme Court, and it was one of the points in which FDR certainly took action that made him look bad by both sides of the party. Roosevelt, after these acts were found unconstitutional, Roosevelt actually tried to pack the Supreme Court. He tried to have the Supreme, he tried to encourage Supreme Court justices to step down. Of course, remember, this is Warren G. Harding's Supreme Court, basically. And so he tried to encourage some of these old justices, the Warren G. Harding justices, to step down. When he couldn't get that, he tried to, and this is in 1936, this is his second term, he tried to expand the number of seats on the Supreme Court. He was basically kind of trying to pack the court. And it was seen it was very unpopular for Democrats and Republicans alike for Roosevelt to attempt to tinker with the Supreme Court in such a way. The Wagner Act was responsible for establishing the National Labor Relations Board, and it also legitimized unions and was a big step forward for African American workers. Just an example of a farmer during the Depression. Proud not to be in relief, but it is during the Depression where you really see the practice of subsidizing farms really take hold. At first, the AAA, which is the Agricultural Adjustment Act, was found unconstitutional, and that involved paying farmers basically not to farm. The problem with farmers was to overproduction, and so they would pay farmers to actually not grow anything. It was replaced by a second act that instead of paying them not to farm, it paid them a little bit extra to farm certain kinds of crops, like soybeans, for example. FDR, of course, was a very controversial president during his time. I mean, he had a wide support of the populace pretty much throughout his presidency, and certainly FDR is one of the last presidents where it would not be uncommon for a working class individual to have FDR's picture on the wall in their house. But he certainly had enemies. The business community certainly called him socialist often, especially in the campaigns during the second term. And certainly it did represent an expansion of government power, but he received a lot of animosity, particularly from those in the communities in the United States that preferred a less regulated capitalist system. But then it's important to note what FDR is facing. FDR is facing the ultimate crisis in the United States. And he's trying, in his mind, he's trying to prevent the rise of a true kind of socialism, a liberal socialism in the country, if you will. He's also concerned about the rise of rightist fascism. And then he's also concerned, and these are things that are happening in the world, of course. And then, of course, he's also concerned with, you know, capitalists who are promoting an unregulated capitalist philosophy that, if you follow through at this time, is almost inevitably going to cause the Depression to only become worse and worse. So he really, really wanted to take action to stabilize the United States. And that's really what the New Deal was all about. And I think it was very successful in that regard. The Dust Bowl, of course, was one of the most notorious of the Great Depression crises. And dust from storms like this actually, in some cases, traveled as far as steamers in the harbors around New York City. The causes of the Dust Bowl were a really bad drought in the mid-30s, but also bad practices with farming, particularly dry farming, and a lack of wind buffers. One of the things that the Civilian Conservation Corps did was to plant trees in the Midwest to act as wind buffers and prevent this kind of thing from happening again. Recovery, which was the third R, relief, reform, and recovery. Education was one way to recover, and you see in the picture here, WPA, the Works Progress Administration, using adult education to help people who have lost their farms train and retool. Also, of course, the Tennessee Valley Authority. The Tennessee Valley Authority was one of the most successful New Deal programs. It was also one of the most controversial, and it was on the Tennessee River in Tennessee. And the Tennessee Valley Authority was a government company, a government corporation that built dams and operated hydroelectric power for the area, for the areas around, and as well as providing areas of recreation for boaters and fishermen and so on and so forth. But what they did is they employed people to build the dams, and then they employed people to run the dams. This was all federal government run. And then they would obviously sell the energy, cheap energy, to the people around the area. And it allowed FDR and his administration to get a real understanding of how much it cost to run one of these facilities and how much it cost to provide energy. And it gave them a gauge to determine when price gouging was happening. And this really, really angered big business interests that controlled the production of power in the United States. But it was very, very successful. And of course, people in Tennessee still to this day recreate on lakes and receive their energy from Tennessee Valley Authority dams. You know, we've talked about this. We talked about this in the 20s, and I've been kind of going over this, but if you need a refresher on the Keynesian economic things, you know, you might take a look at this. Keynesian economics is basically the idea of using controlled inflationary spending to create jobs and create economic growth in one way or another. And very much the 30s, the New Deal is a contrast to the reality of the 20s. So last slide here, did the New Deal solve the Depression? Well, the short answer is no, not completely at least. It helped, and it helped a lot in the long term. The New Deal stabilized the era. No question about it that the New Deal lessened how bad the Depression was going to be. If you hadn't done anything, there's no telling how bad it would have gotten, and there's no telling what the consequence would have been for the United States. And so unquestionably, the New Deal absolutely stabilized the situation. No question about it. It provided jobs, it provided, in which was a psychological thing, it provided relief in the form of Social Security and things and unemployment to people, and it did some major things in the long term, particularly in terms of regulation. The SEC, the FDIC, obviously relief like Social Security, really, really big reforms in the long term, and until recently, controlling bank activity on the market was a big one too. And that might be one to think about being monitored more closely by the SEC in the future. I'm sure that the SEC is because of what happened in 2008. But those are some great long-term examples of the successes of the New Deal. Reforms to the market, reforms to the banking system, development of necessary relief and necessary safety nets for the American people like Social Security. But it doesn't pull the United States out of the Depression. It instead, it lessens the impact of the Depression. It stabilizes the Depression. There was actually a little mini Depression in the late 30s. But it's important to note that because you'll hear a lot, you'll hear somebody say, oh, well, the New Deal didn't end the Depression. What ended the Depression was World War II. And one has to think about what they're saying when they say that. Because if you say that World War II ended the Depression, which there's a strong argument to that, but if you say that, then ultimately the argument that's being made is that basically the huge amount of government activity and government spending and government subsidizing of the economy through inflationary spending during World War II pulled the country economically out of the Depression. And so if you look at it from that standpoint, World War II, if that was what solved the Depression, is really little more than a New Deal program on steroids. World War II was the most wide-scale government action in terms of building, construction, and manpower that the country had ever seen. And many will make the argument that World War II pulled us out of the Depression because of that. And it's important to note that if that is the case, which there's a strong argument that it is, then in fact, it's not an indictment of the New Deal. It's actually saying instead that the New Deal didn't go far enough when it came to spending and empowering the labor force. At least that would be one take on it. It's important to think about that when somebody makes that comment. Anyway, I hope this is helpful. This one was actually kind of being a, kind of wind up being a little long, so hopefully it's helpful. I mean, there's a lot more we could talk about with the New Deal era, but gotta end it now. Thanks, guys.